Hi, today I'd like to discuss the main points in Michael Long's paper, How to Avoid Machine Learning Pitfalls, a Guide for Academic Researchers. This paper aims to describe some of the most typical errors made while employing machine learning techniques as well as how to prevent them. It focuses on topics that are particularly important in academic research, such as the necessity to conduct fair comparisons and reach valid conclusions. This guide was prepared by a professor and focuses on lessons learned while doing ML research in academia and mentoring machine learning research students. It's mostly intended towards machine learning noobs, such as students and other researchers who are just getting started in the area, like myself. This article has helpful hints for each step of machine learning process, which I will attempt to explain in this video. Before you start to build models. Although it may seem appealing to rush into creating cool models with a few lines of code, but you should take time to think about the goals of a project, comprehend the data, and understand what has already been done in your field. Otherwise, you'll have a hard time for choosing the right model and publishing your results. Do take the time to understand your data. If you train your model using bad data, then you will most likely generate a bad model. A process known as garbage in, garbage out. Always begin by making sure your data makes sense. Do some exploratory data analysis. Look for missing or inconsistent records. Don't look at all your data. As you look at data, it is quite likely that you will spot insights that guide your modeling. It is important that you do not make untestable assumptions that will later feed into your model. To ensure this is the case, you should avoid looking closely at any test data in the initial analysis stage. Do make sure you have enough data. If you don't have enough data, then it may not be possible to train a model that generalizes. This depends on the signal-to-noise ratio in the dataset. If the signal is strong, then you can get away with less data. If it's weak, you need more data. If you can collect more data, cross-validation can help you make better use of what you have. You can use data augmentation techniques to boost small datasets. Data augmentation is also useful in situations where you have limited data in certain parts of your dataset. If you just have a little amount of data, you'll probably need to keep the complexity of your machine learning models to a minimum. This is an effective method of avoiding overfitting tiny datasets with too many parameters. Do talk to domain experts. Domain experts can help you understand which problems are useful to solve. They can also help you choose the most appropriate feature set and ML model to use. Failing to consider the opinion of domain experts can lead to projects which don't solve useful problems or which solve them inappropriately. Do survey the literature. You're probably not the first person to throw ML at a particular problem domain. It's important to understand what has and hasn't been done previously. To ignore previous studies is to potentially miss out on valuable information. Do a literature review before you start work, or you'll be left scrambling. Do think about how your model will be deployed. While many academic studies are not intended to produce models that will be used in the real world, in many other studies, the eventual goal is to produce an ML model that can be deployed in a real-world situation. If you want to deploy your model in the real world, there are some things you should think about before getting your hands dirty creating the ML model. For example, if a model is going to be deployed in a resource-limited environment, it may place limitations on the complexity of the model. If there are time constraints, for example, a classification of a signal is required within milliseconds, this also needs to be taken into account. How to reliably build models. Given that with libraries like scikit-learn, you can implement ML models in several lines of code, you might get lost in a disorganized mess of experiments that's hard to justify and hard to write up. As a result, it is critical to approach model creation in an organized manner, ensuring that data is used appropriately and giving enough thought to model selection. Don't allow test data to leak in the training process. A common problem is allowing information about data to leak into the configuration, training, or selection of models. When this happens, the data no longer provides a reliable measure of generality. This is a common reason why published ML models often fail to generalize to real-world data. There are a number of ways that information can leak from a test set. The best thing to prevent these issues is to partition off a subset of your data right at the start of your project. This way, you can only use this independent test set once to measure the generality of a single model. Do try out a range of different models. There is no such thing as a single best ML model for every problem. The no free lunch theorem shows that no ML approach is any better than any other when considered over every possible problem. Given that modern Python ML packages make it easy to try out various models with very little code modifications, there is no reason not to do so and see which one works best for you. Don't use inappropriate models. Modern machine learning packages make it simple to apply inappropriate models to your data. Don't choose a model based on its novelty. Old, well-established models frequently perform better than new ones. For example, if you just have a little amount of data or the underlying pattern is basic, a deep neural network isn't the best option. Do optimize your model's hyperparameters. Many models have hyperparameters, which are numbers that affect the model's configuration. The kernel function in an SVM and the number of trees in a random forest are examples of these. It's preferable to utilize a hyperparameter optimization strategy, which is much easier to justify when writing up. When you have a limited number of parameters, basic techniques like random search and grid search are useful. If this isn't the case, AutoML approaches can be utilized to improve the choice of model and its hyperparameters. Do be careful where you optimize hyperparameters and select features. When carrying out hyperparameter optimization and feature selection, it is important to treat them as part of model training. A particularly common error is to do feature selection on the whole dataset before model training begins. This will result in information leaking from the test set into the training process. You should use the same data for training as well as model optimization or feature selection. One way to do so is called nested cross-validation, which is a kind of cross-validation that includes hyperparameter optimization and feature selection as an additional loop within the main cross-validation loop. How to robustly evaluate models. You must have valid results from which you may draw trustworthy conclusions in order to contribute to development in your profession. It's all too simple to evaluate machine learning models unfairly, muddying the waters of academic progress. As a result, you should take testing and reporting very seriously. Do use an appropriate test set. Using a test set to measure the generality of an ML model is important. The data in the test set should not overlap with the training set, and it should be representative of the wider population. For example, if all of our data, including the test set, is collected on a sunny day, then our model will probably not generalize on other situations. So, our test set should contain some photos taken in other circumstances as well. Do use a validation set. It's critical not to include the test sets in the training process directly. Instead, performance should be measured using an independent validation set. This is a collection of samples that are not directly involved in training, but are used to guide training. Another advantage of having a validation set is that you can conduct early stopping, which means you can stop training as soon as the validation set's error is higher than it was the last time it was checked. Do evaluate a model multiple times. Many ML models are unstable. That is, if you train them multiple times or if you make small changes to the training data, then their performance varies significantly. For this reason, it is common to carry out multiple evaluations of a model. Cross-validation is particularly popular and comes in numerous varieties. Do save some data to evaluate your final model instance. Evaluation of the potential of a general model differs from that of a specific model instance. Cross-validation is beneficial in the first case, but not so much in the second. You may believe that its test fault score is a good indicator of its performance, but it isn't. If you have enough data, set some aside and use it just once to produce an unbiased estimate of the final model instance. Don't use accuracy with imbalanced datasets. Be cautious about the metrics you choose to evaluate your machine learning models. The most widely used measure in classification models, for example, is accuracy. As long as your classes are balanced, this works great, but many datasets aren't. For instance, consider a dataset in which 90% of examples belong to one class, and 10% of the examples belong to another. Despite being utterly useless, a binary classifier that always returns the first class, regardless of its input, would have a 90% accuracy. The Cohen's kappa coefficient or Matthew's correlation coefficient would be preferred in this case. How to compare models fairly? If you compare models unjustly, you risk leading other researchers astray. Comparing models is the foundation of academic research, yet getting it correctly is surprisingly challenging. Make sure you evaluate different models in the same context and look at things from different perspectives. Don't assume a bigger number means a better model. Bigger doesn't always mean better in machine learning research, as it does in many other aspects of life. There are a number of reasons why a greater number does not necessarily suggest a better model. Small variations in performance may be due to whether or not the models were trained or evaluated on different partitions of the same dataset. Another factor that contributes to unfair comparisons is the inability to apply the same level of hyperparameter optimization to all models when comparing them. To be sure of a fair comparison, you should implement all of the models you're comparing from scratch, optimize them to the same degree, and run several tests. Do use a statistical test when comparing models. There are two categories of tests for comparing individual ML models. The first is used to compare individual model instances, such as two trained decision trees. For example, McNamara's test is a fairly common choice for comparing two classifiers, and works by comparing the classifier's output labels for each sample in the test set. The second category of tests are used to compare two models more generally. Students.T test is a good choice for this kind of comparison, but it assumes that the data is distributed normally. Mann-Whitney's U test is safer, since it does not assume that the distributions are normal. Do correct for multiple comparisons. Multiple pairwise tests can lead to overly optimistic interpretations of significance. Each time you carry out a comparison between two models using a statistical test, there's a probability that it will discover significant differences where there aren't any. This is known as the multiplicity effect and is an example of a broader issue in data science known as data dredging or p-hacking. To address this problem, you can apply a correction for multiple tests. The most common approach is the Bonifroni correction. Don't always believe results from community benchmarks. The use of benchmark datasets to test new machine learning models has become common. The idea is that comparisons will be more transparent because everyone is using the same data to train and evaluate their models. However, there are several significant disadvantages to this technique, and it might result in too optimistic outcomes. In fact, evaluating many models on the same test set increases the likelihood that the best model just overfits the test set and does not necessarily generalize any better. Do consider combinations of models. Different ML models explore different trade-offs, and by combining them, you can sometimes compensate for the weaknesses of one model by using the strength of another. Such composite models are known as ensembles, and the process of generating them is known as ensemble learning. How to report your results? Academic research is not about self-promotion, but rather about making a contribution to knowledge. You must give a comprehensive account of your effort, including both what worked and what didn't. Trade-offs are common in machine learning, and you should try to reflect this with a detailed and thoughtful approach. Do be transparent. Be transparent about what you have done and share your results. It's good practice to share your models in an accessible way. For instance, if you used a script to implement all your experiments, then share the script when you publish the results. This makes it easier for people to compare models and ensure fair comparisons. Do report performance in multiple ways. It is possible to provide a more complete overview of your model's performance by combining several data sources. Reporting multiple metrics for each dataset is a smart idea. Alternative metrics might provide you different views on the outcomes and make your job more transparent. If you utilize accuracy, for example, it's a good idea to include measures that are less susceptible to class imbalances. Don't generalize beyond the data. It's important not to present invalid conclusions, since this can lead other researchers astray. A common mistake is to make general statements that are not supported by the data used to train and evaluate models. Don't overplay your findings and be aware of their limitations. Do be careful when reporting statistical significance. Some statistical tests are conservative, underestimating significance, whereas others are liberal, overestimating significance. Some other factor to examine is if the distinction between two models is significant. Even when the difference in performance is little, if you have enough samples, you may always detect significant differences. Do look at your models. Many authors just report the trained model's performance metrics without commenting on what it really learned. However, the goal of research is to develop information and insight and then share it with others in the field. So take a look inside your models and attempt to figure out how they make decisions. It might also be helpful to give visualizations of your models for relatively simple models like decision trees. To extract information from complicated models, such as deep neural networks, explainable AI approaches could be used. They won't tell you exactly what the model is doing, but they could provide some useful insights. Some of the points I made in this video may be incorrect or at the very least debatable. Almost often, the theory of how to perform machine learning lags behind the practice. What we believe to be true today may not be true tomorrow. You have to approach machine learning with an open mind and the humility to accept you don't know everything. Thanks for watching. I hope you find this video educational and informative. If you like this video, please subscribe to my channel. See you in the next video.